And good afternoon to you, Naveen Chawla. Great pleasure to be with you. It's a privilege to converse with you at this very elegant venue. Of course, you have been introduced as the Chief Election Commissioner, and you have made major contributions to the election system in India. And you have this book now for us as a blessing so that we can understand, read, and comprehend what you have done. But before that, can we touch upon your other multifarious activities and the kind of personality that you are? You may recall that I saw you first in Washington when you were invited by President Clinton for a prayer breakfast. And I also remember it was a time when the Lewinsky crisis was at its height. What are your recollections of that, very briefly?
Is this on? You reminded me of my visit to Washington and the meeting with the Clintons at the National Prayer Breakfast. That was a very tense morning. It was the morning actually when the Monica Lewinsky story had broken out in the press, and there was a lot of tension between President Clinton and Mrs. Clinton. But when I was being introduced, I was introduced not as an IAS officer, I was introduced as the biographer of Mother Teresa. So when that was mentioned to President Clinton, he turned to his wife, because Hillary Clinton was known to be close to the Missionaries of Charity, known to be close to Mother Teresa. So he said, he is the author of the book on Mother Teresa, and she said, yes, I have the book. And then I said, Mr. President, you know, you have a very remarkable wife, because on the day that Mother Teresa was actually buried in Calcutta, at the actual burial ceremony, I and my family were there with about 300 nuns who could fit into the room. And for those of you who have been to Calcutta and Mother House, you would have seen it's not a very big hall. And so about 300 people, and into that came Mrs. Clinton. And one of the young sisters said to her, Mrs. Clinton, tell us about Mother Teresa. And she spoke very movingly, and she said, do you know that every single face I see here, every single face reminds me of Mother Teresa. And we in America, and I personally with my husband, will always be there for you. So I reminded President and Mrs. Clinton of that morning.
I remember since I was in Washington as the Deputy Chief of Mission, I was reporting every day to the government of India that tomorrow Clinton will resign. And finally we said, if Clinton were the Titanic, the iceberg would have broken. Such a Teflon-coated president he was. Anyway, coming back to Mother Teresa, that was one of the reasons why you were invited to this breakfast, I know, because we were told that it is that capacity that you are there. So it's a very touching subject for you, but a few words about her personally.
I was very close to Mother Teresa, but I happened to write the book 15 years after I got to first meet her, and she had said something very funny, and we all laughed, my wife and I and she and the sisters. Then suddenly, impromptu, I said, you know, Mother, so many books have been written, but nobody brings out your sense of joy, your sense of humor. I think I should write. No. So much has been written. So then I said something I regret to this day. You know, we all say something sometime that we regret. So one of the things that I regret saying was, why, Mother, as a Hindu, can't I write? And why, Mother, as a civil servant, can't I write? And then I was very embarrassed.
She had to say yes.
And she had to say yes.
Right. Well, and following that, you just simply, you did not stop by simply admiring her or writing about her. You followed her path in a way, by opening up this social work that you have initiated, work among the lepers, for example. Leprosy is one region in which, area in which you have done a lot of work for the poor people of India. Something on that?
She told me, one day I wanted to resign from the IAS, and she said, no, you must stay, and she made me promise. But I said, if I join you, then I can do a lot of other work. She said, no, what you can do, I can't do. Anyway, when the book got written, she said, what you can do, I can't do. I said, Mother, you can't compare me to yourself. I'm nothing. So She said, no, in government you can do so many things to help me. Anyway, so I stayed. But what happened then was that when the book got written and the first royalty check came from England, I took it to her in Calcutta in 1992 and I said, how can I keep it? I can't keep the money for a book written on your name. So I set up a leprosy trust called the Lepra India Trust, and we look after leprosy patients, leprosy sufferers, and the healthy children of leprosy patients.
Out of the royalty.
I have never kept the royalty.
How noble it is that he should have dedicated all his royalty to Mother Teresa's own work. Well, now coming to the election commission for which you are famous, I would like to ask you, but there have been several improvements, several, shall we say, dramatic changes in the election commission rules and the way it is practiced. Since we have a very young audience, you might want to remember how you decided to give voting rights to the transgenders for the first time. The young people here will not even imagine there was a situation when transgenders had no votes. Unbelievable, isn't it? But at that time, it was revolutionary. What was it like and what prompted you to do that?
You know, I was addressing students in Bhubaneswar at a particular college, and in the question and answer session, almost simultaneously many hands came up, and one hand on the left like this as I face you was a young man, and then there was a lady on the other side, and both of them almost simultaneously said, why don't you recognize the transgender as a separate category? Now, the truth is that I had never thought of this. I mean, I had no idea of the transgender beyond just the definition of it. So when these students elaborated to me, I thought to myself, why not? So, and just a few, maybe a week later, I was in Chennai addressing the students of the Asian College of Journalism. And again, a young lady asked me the same question. So when I went back to Delhi, I found that we did not have to turn to Parliament for any legislative change.
There was no legislation as such against them.
There was no legislation. And as a result, we were able to change the rules. Under the rules, then we had three columns. M for male, F for female, and we introduced O for other. 3 years later, the High Court of Delhi made that T. T for transgender instead of O for other.
But this is by their own declaration. There is no other independent verification of any.
It is by their declaration, and I now note that more and more people are asking for the cards under T for transgender.
Yeah, anyway, that kind of feeling that people had about that has disappeared. But I raised it simply because for us, now it is an accepted fact. But when he started it, when he introduced it, it was a revolution. That was. Are you all aware of that now? Are you
all aware of the transgender factor for elections? Please raise your hands if you are. Well.
But did you face any opposition?
No, because it was within our commission, a little opposition. You know, all bureaucratic officials first begin by saying no.
It's conservative all the time.
Which you know. First no, then yes. So when they said no, then I said, what is the problem? Explain to me. So they said, sir, problem can be that, for example, your name may come in for O for other. I said, doesn't matter. If it comes, I'll write to the election commission and you'll change it. But it's not a major impediment. So when there was no major impediment, we went ahead and it got done.
Well, when we talk of election commission, the first name that comes up to us even before Naveen Chawla is that of Mr. Sheshan. He is the one who actually brought the election commission to the limelight in the country. Very few people knew there was something called an election, chief election commission. And what are your impressions? What are your memories of him? Did you follow him in any way?
In many ways, as you, anyone who will look at this book, either buy it or read it in a library when it comes out, Mr. Sheshan is my unspoken hero. And you know, no matter when you get appointed, whoever gets appointed into the election commission has to face political flak from this party or that party or all parties. So when I was facing a lot of flak, I usually called on Mr. Sheshan when I went to Chennai. And I always sit at the edge of my chair because, you know, he's been cabinet secretary and I was only a joint secretary. So I still hold him in great regard. So when he looked at me, he said, "Do you see my skin? Do you see my skin?" So I didn't know what to say. What is he asking me? So I said, "Yes, sir." With Mr. Session, it was always, "Yes, sir, yes, sir." So, "Yes, sir." So he said, "Look carefully, because it is the skin of a rhinoceros. And until you don't develop the skin of the rhinoceros, you cannot do your work in the election commission. So develop a thick skin." So that was his advice to me.
That reminds me of a very nice story about Natwar Singh. He joined the Congress party. He was a diplomat. And Mrs. Gandhi blessed him. And as he was leaving, he said, "Ma'am, I have to go and buy a few sets of khadi clothes now that I'm a congressman." And she said, "It is better to have several layers of thick skin. That is more important."
Well, that's what Mr. Session meant, and that is the advice that I followed. And that's also in this book.
Let me also tell you a little Session story. When the Secretary General of the United Nations came to Delhi, Dr. Boutros Ghali, the Prime Minister told me that you introduce him to Mr. Session. Because Prime Minister never told me what was the reason. So I said, "I'll go and speak to him and fix a meeting with Dr. Boutros Ghali." So I went to him, and then he already knew what Prime Minister wanted. Prime Minister wanted Session to get a job in the United Nations as Under Secretary General, in a way to get rid of him from the Election Commission. So as soon as he see me, he said, "You have come to ask me to get a job in the United Nations?" He said, "Sir, I don't know. But tell your Prime Minister that the only job I want is his job, which I cannot get."
Now, if I had known this story earlier, I would have put it in the book.
He says, "The only job I want is the Prime Minister of India's job. And that Narasimha Rao cannot give me. So ask him to keep quiet." He didn't see the secretary.
But you know, I have to take up from this for a little story that he and Narasimha Rao were not getting on. I mean, they were getting on very badly. So one day, in an interchange with Narasimha Rao, who was Prime Minister after all, Session said, "You cannot get rid of me. I am not going to oblige you by dying. You cannot transfer me. And if you try and impeach me in Parliament, you will fail." So Mr. Narasimha Rao did nothing, but Prime Ministers are far more powerful than any Chief Election Commissioner. So a few weeks later, when Mr. Session's plane landed in Pune, then called Pune, in a time when there were no mobile phones, the press met him at the airport with saying, "Do you know, sir, that there are two more election commissioners?" Apparently, during that two-hour flight, the notification had been signed that Dr. Gill and Mr. G.V.G. Krishnamurti would be two additional commissioners. So now it became a three-member commission.
All right. Your book is still not released. So I'm sure everybody will be a little bit keen to know what exactly it is, what is the main message, and what is the content of it. The book will be available at the Jaipur festival, I believe, and therefore it is still not released here, but I just had the good fortune to receive a copy and I'm looking forward to reading. But how would you summarize it in a few words?
You know, I would say of this book that one is that the election machine runs very well. The second thing is that if you all cast your mind over our region and other countries that got independence from colonial rule at about the same time, you will find that the Indian electoral narrative and the Indian political narrative is still very impressive. We hold all our elections in time. They're held on time each time. And whatever the result is, you may not have thought about it, but whatever the result is, it is accepted by the loser and the winner alike. There are many countries that I go to as electoral observer, where for months the final result is not accepted by the opposition. So this is a great triumph for India and Indian democracy, and the way the Indian election conducts itself and conducts elections, general elections and state elections. The Election Commission does not conduct municipal or panchayat elections. The other thing I want to say is that while in the Election Commission things are done very well, some of the things are going wrong. We have too much money power. We have criminality coming into the ranks. In the current Lok Sabha, 30% of the members of parliament have criminal cases against them, not all serious, but at least 16% is for heinous offense.
But you are partly responsible for that, because you allowed people on trial to be able to vote and also contest.
Well, that's a legislation which I have tried to oppose, but you know, whatever recommendations...
That happened during your time.
Yes. And we keep writing to the Prime Minister sends it to the Law Minister sends it to Parliament, Parliament sends it to a select committee, and in the end, nothing comes of it. So most of our recommendations on criminality, on money power, on transparency of collection of funds, where do they come from, how are they spent, many of these things where we want answers and we want legislative changes, have not been affected by any government. Please let it not be said that I'm saying it for this government. I retired in 2010, and we were writing from 1992 to 2010 and from 2010 to 2017. And yet, no significant change has
happened. It has only become slightly worse, isn't it? But anyway, we have a very great reputation, because even United States, which is supposed to be the Mecca of democracy, there have been cases like it happened, the case of Al Gore and President Bush, how the election was declared not by the electoral authorities but by the Supreme Court of the United States. We haven't gone to that extent. Or we never had butterfly ballots where you could not make out for whom you had voted. It happened in the US. The name is somewhere and you had to mark somewhere else. And in the process, thousands of votes became invalid. So this kind of thing we have not faced. And the other thing is, everybody understands that there are problems. And the magnitude is always noted. But there has never been an accusation that the elections have been either not free or not fair. And that is something creditable, isn't it, for a huge operation like
this? It is incredibly credible. It is fantastic that so far in 70 years, and I ask you, without naming any nation, to look around you and look at those countries who got independence from colonial rule between 1947, 48, 49, 50, see where they are. And without naming a nation in Africa, I will say that you might recollect that about a year ago, not so long ago, the chief officer who was in charge of the electronic voting machine was not only murdered, he was murdered brutally. And his body, it was not as if his body disappeared. His body was left in public view in a ditch on the side of the road. What was that message? So I'm giving you a comparison between one such. And in any case, our constitutional fathers were so wise that they excluded the role of the courts during the election process. And it is only when the process is declared closed can you or somebody else go in an election petition.
Yeah, in other words, it doesn't replace the power of the election.
Absolutely.
Well, you mentioned the machine. That has been a controversy recently. There have been even suggestions, was it by the Congress party, that this should be abolished altogether and we must go back to the old ballot box. So where does it stand now? Now it's generally accepted, acknowledged, and it's going to continue?
With your permission, sir, may I ask this question of the audience? May I ask you all, because I have a certain view which I'll share, but may I ask you all that those of you who doubt the machine, Will you raise your hands for me?
Lot of hands.
Oh, this is frightening. Now, I have to tell you why I consider it frightening.
But this is with the VVPAT. You know what VVPAT is. That is the new addition, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So with the VVPAT, you can verify your own vote, whether it has reached the right person. So in that case, would you still raise your hands against the machine?
Yes, yes, they'll still.
But less.
But less. Less. Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what I believe. Because I believe it from my head and I believe it from my heart. I believe the electronic voting machine is what the Karnataka High Court described in 2004 as a wonder machine. This electronic voting machine, the first time it was used in Kerala. It was used in a by-election in Parur in 1982. Thereafter, it was challenged in Kerala. Thereafter, it went from Kerala to the High Court, to the Supreme Court, because a necessary amendment in the Act had to come about in the Representation of People Act, and that was done. So the first voices raised, first place it is tried is Kerala, first voices raised Kerala. The Kerala High Court has seen it, the Karnataka High Court has seen it, the Delhi High Court has seen it, and the Nagpur bench of the Bombay High Court has examined. So this machine of ours is a bit like your what used to be before the mobile phone came. Many of us had pocket calculators. Now the calculators were, that chip could only do six functions plus minus. So this EVM is basically an adding machine like a calculator. It cannot be linked to a computer. Then the VVPAT.
It's just accounting.
It's a counting machine. Now, after I finished doing the 2009 general election, the results were declared in May, and in July, Mr. Subramaniam Swamy and others came and said that no, we don't have faith in the EVM. Many other people also came. So in a hall in the Election Commission, we put 100 machines, 10 from different states, we put cameras, and we said, now anyone who wants to come, please come and hack the machine, but here. So some people wanted to take the machine away for reverse engineering. Some people wanted to take it home. Some people said, let us take the photographs. But that we could not allow. I mean, even I as election commissioner and chief election commissioner can't take the machine home. It's made by two companies. And nobody could demonstrate in the hall, if it was an average polling station, that you could rig it. So the compromise thereafter with Mr. Swamy was, he said, all right, he gave an affidavit to say that's okay, but all right, let's have a voter verifiable paper trail. So that took a few years to develop, and it will now be used in the general election. So you can, within 10 seconds of casting your vote, verify. Because it's like a roll, you can't take your slip away, but you can see whether.
That is reassuring in a sense. So, voting machines are there to stay. There is no.
I hope so. Now, after all that I've said to you, I think you hope so too.
Right.
Otherwise, we'll be counting for the next 3 days. Because when I did the election, we had 714. Million voters, all of Europe and Russia put together, all of Africa put together, all of North and South America put together. Then in 2014, there were 816 million people on our voting list. And this time, I think it'll be 900 and something voters on our list. So
but even with the machines, you take a long time to count and declare election. Sometimes 10 days later, sometimes 1 month later. And that's a bit of a tension, isn't it, during that period? Nothing works, people are waiting for the results. Can't this be shortened?
You mean the phases of polling?
Yeah, no, after the polling.
The counting is actually quite quick, but the press criticizes.
It's the last phase of the polling that holds it.
Because from between the last date of polling we leave 1 or 2 days for any repolling, any repolls if necessary, and then 1 day in between. For example, when in 2009, my last day of polling was the 13th, and on the 16th, we had declared the result. So the gap is narrow, but we are criticized that why do you have so many phases? Why does it go on over 5 weeks, 6 weeks?
Good. Because many countries like US, for example, the same day you know the results. Even before the, while the voting is over, because it's already a machine, they just count it.
So but you've been ambassador, you spent 10 years at the UN and in Washington and New York. We never make the mistakes that the US does in the
elections. That's what I started with.
Ever.
Butterfly balance being one of them. That's very commendable. Two other things I'd like to ask you. One is this NOTA. Do you envisage a situation where NOTA will one day win the elections?
Yes, it could happen. More and more people are taking the trouble to come to the booth and vote for NOTA. But if NOTA is ever to result in a repoll, then again that needs legislative amendment.
Otherwise you will not count it.
Well, you know, one, what will happen is that suppose people are voting and more votes come for NOTA, then people like us are going to demand of the Election Commission that that is either a repoll or that election should be declared invalid, something. But whatever people are wanting, we will have to take that back to Parliament to make a change in the law.
Right, but that of course is saying that you do not trust any of them. And that's a major statement that these people are making. The second thing about which Kerala is very keen and anxious is the voting of the Pravasi, overseas Indians. So there are two categories. Overseas Indians who are Indian nationals, fair enough, they should have the right to vote. But that's not the only demand. We have also people of Indian origin who are citizens of other countries. Because US and Israel, etc., allow that, they are also aspiring to get voting rights in India. And that, of course, is ruled out mostly, I know. But about the Pravasis voting, that if they come here, they can vote, is now already in place. But now, the government is thinking of allowing them to vote from abroad, either by postal vote or in the mission. How far is it progressing?
Well, postal vote can be a possibility. It is not being done for this election. It can be a possibility. Voting in the missions is almost impossible. Because one of the things is that we also have a model code of conduct. Now that model code of conduct, where did that originate from? Kerala. When did it originate? 60s. How did it originate? Politicians got together and said, okay, let's behave like this. Then that matter went up to the Election Commission, and then it went to the courts, which ratified it. So we have a model code of conduct that you can do this, you can do that. You can't do this, you can't do that. Now, while we can enforce it in India through our returning officers, through our observers, we can't very well do that, say, in Sharjah or Dubai or Kuwait. In any case, it would mean a politician or the candidates from here going there to canvass. Those countries don't allow an assembly of more than 5 or 10 people. So, you know, the way that we electioneer in India can't be replicated there easily. Then if we have it in one embassy, we have to have it in 180.
And also, if it is a presidential election, it is practical.
Yeah.
With so many seats to be contested in different parts of India, it's not practical at all.
So it becomes very difficult for us to actually make it practical in another country. But you might ask that why not an electronic vote of some kind through a computer? But the moment we open our adding machine to any kind of computer system, we have to have so many firewalls in place. Because you know, as I've said in this book, every vote counts. But you also perhaps remember that people have won elections or lost elections by one vote. Now, we are such clever people, there's so much technical expertise out there, that if we get into any kind of a computer-based system and something is hacked, then what will remain of of the election commission, the election process, the results, there would be tremendous confusion in the country. So until we come to that day when such good firewalls can be established that not a single vote can be hacked, then perhaps we could link up to a computer, and then our people need not have to come all the way from the Gulf or wherever to cast their vote in their constituency.
Maybe turn this question to the audience. How many of you are happy that the Pravasi vote is taking place? Or you think there are dangers in it? If you think you are happy, please raise your hand. Yes, it's almost universally welcomed, I think. All your relatives are able to come back.
No, so happy means that they want the Pravasi to come or don't
yes,
want
the
Pravasi?
They want the Pravasis to vote.
Oh, they do?
Yeah.
Okay.
But of course, the other question of people of Indian origin being able to vote, you rule out completely. Because it is a dual nationality issue.
Yes, because you see, whoever has to vote is a voter who's ordinarily resident in a particular constituency for 6 months. So if you're there for 6 months, you can register. For example, if a student is from, say, Bihar, but is studying in Kochi, if that student wishes to transfer her vote from Bihar to Kochi, where she is ordinarily resident in a college for 6 months, that can be done. And then she can vote in an election in Kochi. But I find from my experience that most people want to retain their vote in either their home village or their hometown or, you know, their home city.
Annual visit is also welcome there.
Yes.
That's very good. So now I think we will, if you agree, we will open up for questions. But before that, one last question for me is about the troubles that you had towards the end of your tenure. You were accused of being friendly to the Congress party. How far true is it, number one? And has it affected your functioning in any manner? Were they justified in asking for your removal?
You know, when I was appointed to the Election Commission, after about a year, I began to face a huge amount of flak from a political party that was accusing me of being pro-Congress.
You are associated with Sanjay Gandhi, were you?
Sanjay, the Gandhi family, they said, and they said generally with the Congress. So they said, you're going to favor the Congress party. So this went on for a while. Now, because one is in the Election Commission and one is not a politician, one doesn't on this subject call a daily press conference, because we are civil servants, you know, we've been in the Foreign Service and the IAS, we don't go out easily. So a few statements were made officially by the Election Commission. But I thought to myself that everybody who is appointed has to be appointed by some government. Even a judge. Today, judges are appointed to the Supreme Court directly from the bar also. So some government appoints them. In the United States, we've had the most remarkable judges appointed by various administrations. But what happens is that when you sit on a particular chair, whether you are election commissioner, chief election commissioner, judge of the High Court, judge of the Supreme Court, chief justice, you have only one constituency in front of you. You can only have one. And that is the people of India. And in a post as election commissioner and later as chief election commissioner, I was in absolutely no doubt that I would do the elections as the fairest of umpires. But the proof of the pudding is always in the eating, isn't it? So when I became chief election and I completed the 2009 general election, then there was nothing but applause internationally and nationally, and not a single word of criticism. So that is where the proof finally lay.
And one more small question. You have been election observers in other countries, but we are often asked whether we would accept foreign observers in our election. Have you ever accepted them? If not, why?
No, we don't accept observers because we already have an observation machinery which is built in. Those countries don't have that observation machinery. Yes, I have been invited to elections in many countries.
The United Nations sends you also.
I actually set up a group within the Commonwealth Secretariat. Because Kamlesh Sharma at that time came to see me, he was Secretary General, and said, you know, India is the largest country of the Commonwealth, the largest democratic country, and so will you set up a group? So we set up a group, and we do go on the invitation only of any particular Commonwealth country. But here, when people used to ask me, and ambassadors of various countries, we said, look, from the embassies, please go anywhere you wish. So in 2000, many ambassadors asked me, can we go to Kashmir? Yes, please go to Kashmir. Don't expect me to make the arrangements, but please go where you want. And I have to say that there was a lady ambassador who was almost the dean of the diplomatic corps, the ambassador for Venezuela, and she covered 30,000 kilometers by plane and road and even drove pillion on mobikes as she went around the country. And later on, all these ambassadors came to see us and said, you know, what a textbook election it's been.
Very good. Because some countries, it becomes a requirement. They need to establish their legitimacy. Well, now we are going to open up the session for questions. We have only 18 minutes more. But if you have questions, please give the mic to the person back. Please introduce yourself and make your question very brief so that we can ask as many questions as possible.
Okay, sir, I am Shukur, and my question is that with regard to the voting machine, I remember having read last year, I think, a news item about a situation where even the contestant's vote and his wife's vote were found missing on the machine after counting. The contestant and his wife, they didn't get their own votes after counting. How it happened?
You say the voter and his wife's votes were wrongly counted. That's what wrongly recorded. Can you clarify that again? Question.
I didn't understand the question.
There is a mic.
I don't remember where it was, and I remember having read the news item. I think it was last year, when a lot of uproar was there about the voting machine. One report was there that even the contestant and his wife,
the candidate.
Definitely, they have voted in favor of them. But even those votes were not found.
Went to his opponent. The vote went to his opponent.
Yeah.
How do you know?
No, I don't know. How it happened, I don't know. The news, the person who prepared the news argues that it was rigged or pre-adjusted.
It may have been because of this paper thing. No, he hasn't come to his notice.
Sorry, I haven't come across this, but I want to add something about the EVM, if I may, with your permission.
Yes, please.
And that is that in our system in India, we have a system that the officers who handle the machines are all accountable. I know that in certain counties in the United States there are machines, but sometimes they get volunteers, sometimes they get college students. I've seen that in Mexico, I've seen that in Venezuela. But in India, the returning officer is an IAS officer. Under him is the state machinery, the ADM, the SDM, the Tahsildar, all the officers of the education and other departments, but every single officer is born on either the central government budget or the state government budget and is a government servant. Now, suppose one of you is a district magistrate, then you will be the custodian of those machines in storage for maybe 4 years or 3 years, either until an assembly election or a by-election or the general election. Thereafter, the Election Commission will step in and there will be trials of each machine with the representatives of political parties. Then they will be taken to various political stations at random. The machine even doesn't know whether it's going to go to this booth or that booth or that booth. The presiding officer doesn't know whether he's going to be placed here or there or there or there. The staff don't know until the last day whether they're being appointed to this booth, this booth, this booth, or this booth. So everything is randomized. Then the election takes place. After the election, the polling has taken place. Then it is stored until the day of counting. And then after the counting is over, they are brought back into storage. So the system that we have devised over the years is a system of accountability. Now, if you were the district magistrate, where might a leak take place? And I know that I also read with some alarm recently, but it was clarified by the Election Commission that some machine had gone to the home of a presiding officer recently, and that officer has been punished. But this is how the system of accountability works with the machine.
Yes, the next question. No, please give it to somebody else. Don't. You're taking a picture.
Sir, I am welcoming you to this festival. I had your talk also.
Finish this.
This is democratic country.
Little louder, please.
Yeah, this is democratic country. Then India is a democratic country. Then it's a franchise is having its backbone. Franchise. Unfortunately, never in my life I have seen that more than 80% of people have voted. It means percentage of voting. But abysmically, it is slowing down from 15 to 16% even in the matter of Kashmir, something like that. In these circumstances, do you think that linking Aadhaar with this election machinery and system, is it possible to help in any way of avoiding duplication of vote? That's what the gentleman was talking. Now we are having very, very much secured system of money changing, that is in a bank, some system they are using. I'm a layman in this technical issue, that I don't know. Can this Aadhaar can be used linking with machineries and all, something like that? That is one thing. Then one more small apprehension is that in this town of Calicut, there is a homeopath doctor who got a discovery of applying his medicine to the plant where its root will be doubled. It is confirmed with the scientist of agriculture also. Why I am quoting this example? Likewise, there is a possible, being a machine, electronic machine, being a machine, we are not about its mechanism since we are literary people. So some mileage or some linkage or something has taken place in somebody's mind, isn't it? That's why that particular machine has been taken. You were telling that 10 machines are taken from 10 different parts. What was the selection procedure? We don't know. Whether you are randomly taken or something like that. Still that exists. For addressing that particular issue, if something has been done in a very systematic manner, that in a democratic way, to be precise, it would have done two things.
Yes, one is about the voting percentages. Voting percentages are not more than 80% anyway.
You know, polling percentages sometimes, it tends to be a bit like this. If it is a by-election where the issues are very close to people, there'll be over 80% vote, 75-80. In the Northeast, in Nagaland, Mizoram, it's routine for 90%, 90. When we come to an assembly election, an average will be about 70, because you know these are people's issues. I want a drain, I want a road, I want electricity, etc. When it comes to the general election, it comes down. The general election is about 60 to 64%. In the mother of all democracies, in the UK, it's 50%. So at 60 and between 60 and 65, it's. But may I go and answer your question in a slightly different way also? There has been a demand in some quarters for compulsory voting. Now, how the example given is in Australia, there is compulsory voting. So I asked the Australian Chief Election Commissioner and Australian officials, So he said, if we had to introduce such a legislation today, we wouldn't do it because it's a very expensive system for us. We have to send out 3 registered letters over 6 weeks. And in the end, we spend a lot of money to collect a 20 Australian dollar fine. And it's really not worth it for us. Now look at our country. Our country is also made up of very poor people. They are daily wagers. There's a mother who needs to take her child to the hospital that day. So is she going to take her child to the hospital or is she going to stand in one of our 3-hour queues? You know, isn't it a moral question that we must leave it to the mother and we must leave it to the voter to decide? So that's why I feel that, and let us look at it administratively, sir. Let's say 100 million people don't vote. Where are we going to chase the 100 million? That's more than the 5 times the population of Nepal. The election commission will do nothing but write letters, do no other work. And then when we don't get a response, as it is, our courts are clogged. Now we'll add another 50 million cases to the courts in order to be able to prosecute the people who haven't replied to us.
The collection of money will cost you even much more.
So I think I would just like to link that with Aadhaar in that sense.
Yeah, the Aadhaar is what he was asking about. The linking with Aadhaar, does it improve the situation in any way? That's what you think?
I don't think it's going to make any difference. And the Supreme Court has ruled that the Aadhaar is not compulsory.
Anybody else? You have the mic? Carry on.
Hello, sir. It's an honor to meet you. So my question is, the fact of black money being accepted by political parties in the form of undisclosed cash donation has been a burning issue for some time. In order to show that he was doing something, our Prime Minister Mr. Modi in the budget of 2017-18 proposed an amendment which seeks to bring down the limit of allowed cash donation from 20,000 to 2,000. The reduction permissible cash donation would not make any difference in the black money being accepted by political parties and been shown in cash donation since they are not required to declare the details. So whatever is currently declared as cash donation under 2000 each would now be declared as cash donation under 2000 each. The total amount would remain the same. So your opinion on that?
It was such a long question that I lost you.
Oh, he's asking about corruption.
Huh?
Basically corruption and
corruption is,
and black money.
And black money is terrible. Now let me tell you why I think so. All of us of course believe that people are spending much more than they should. Yes, raise your hands. People, our candidates are spending much more than the statutory limit, isn't it? Yes?
Much more.
Now, the statutory limit for the parliamentary election coming is 70 lakhs. And people are spending many crores. But no matter how much the election commission tries to stop it, the ingenuity of our people and our politicians is amazing. So they are always one or two steps ahead of us. In Karnataka, although in a 2008 election, we seized about 60 crores worth of cash and liquor and freebies, I shudder to think how much they actually spent and got away with. For example, one of our observers kept seeing a milk van going up and down. So when he saw the milk van 2 or 3 times, he stopped the milk van and there was no milk. It was all liquor for the elections. Another lady observer in Andhra Pradesh saw an ambulance going up and down with the siren, you know, blaring. And what did the ambulance have?
Cash.
Cash. So, what do I say? When the limit is something and people are spending many, many times that limit. Now the election commission tries its best, we appoint 2,000 IAS or IRS or Indian Forest Service officials for 1 month to be parked in one constituency so that they can keep track. We ask the public to let us know, to inform us if there is something. Can we raid? We have raiding parties. We have the police at our beck and call and so on and so forth. And yet, I was on television when a by-election was taking place in a constituency of R.K. Nagar in Chennai not very long ago. And there I learnt from the television and their sources that the modus operandi had changed. A 20 rupee note was given to the voter, and after the election, if the 20 rupee unique number was shown, then 1,000, 2,000, 5,000, 10,000, God knows how much, was paid to that voter. Now what do we do? Until you and I are not vigilant in every way, this malaise will never end. And I have a chapter on this and on money power and crime and paid news and fake news in this book also, because these are the things that are going wrong.
Well, sir,
with your permission, sorry for second time. You said three incidents, milk van, that ambulance and this. Why an action has not taken place against them? Action placement, the media should also cover that.
No, the media did cover them. They were all arrested.
Sir, that is only just one.
No, sir, they were all arrested. Cases were going on. And when the state government wanted to withdraw the cases, I said, not a single case can ever be withdrawn except through judicial intervention. Let somebody else ask a question now, sir.
Definitely, anyhow, that justice is not taking place, an ordinary person will be robbed.
Now,
like
sir,
that.
Please, but you must help in the elections. You are a very vigilant gentleman.
All right, who is next? There's somebody at the back. What happened? Mic failed. Yes? You don't have a mic? Extra mic? Yeah, just 2 minutes only. Can you come forward?
Hi, good evening, sir. So my question was pertaining to fake news. So recently, they have seen a tendency of the elections being blamed for the results. So even in India and even recently in the US midterm elections, the president himself says the elections were rigged. So that in itself, it undermines democracy, doesn't it? So how can we protect the sanctity of elections against this fake news machine? That
Donald Trump.
On fake news.
Exactly.
On fake news.
You know, it is perhaps, for my mind today, the single most worrying problem. I have a chapter, but I don't have all the solutions. And we are now going to be seeing, you've seen the role of Cambridge Analytica. You saw what Zuckerberg had to say even to Congress. Very unconvincing.
And how many Russians are involved in it?
And how the Russians are involved and how the whole social media gets involved. This is the single biggest danger. Also to our 1960s Kerala model code of conduct. So we've now reached into the era of fake news. It is a big danger, sir. And if you can study something on it and write to the Election Commission, that will be very worthy of you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Naveen Chawla, for this wonderful conversation that we had. And we have learned a lot from it. And of course, the book is there for all of us to follow and read and understand more. Would you like to say the last word?
Just want to thank you all. Not necessarily to, but I have to tell you that that Mr. Ravi DC, the reason he got me here was because he also wants to translate this book into Malayalam before the general election. So in another month's time, he wants to have the book out on, you know how DC books are, on the first of everything. So he's been my publisher for a long time, published my Mother Teresa book many times. Publishing now in Malayalam, my wife's book on Raja Ravi Varma. And I would say you've been a great audience. And whether or not you read the book, if you have good ideas, please don't fail to send an email to the Election Commission. There's somebody there to take note of it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming.